friends, distinguished guests, Deputy Prime Minister, Minister of State, Mr. Bruno Poisa of the UNDP, Dr. Aldrin Henry Lee, Dr. Heather Ricketts, Head of Department of Sociology, Psychology, and Social Work, friends, colleagues, good morning. Thank you for staying with us throughout this wonderful conference. We know there have been long days, but it's good to see you back here with us this morning, bright and early. I see smiles on your faces in spite of the early start, and I know I've kept you late into the evening, but I hope you'll find that it has been worth it. This morning we have a slight change adjustment to our program before we begin with our closing address from Ms. Tahere, Siisiialafia. We will do two things a little bit special. We want to launch two initiatives. One is a partnership between SALISES and the Caribbean Regional Youth Council on working together to do research, to document youth contributions in the region, to conduct participatory research on development issues. And we will sign this MOU this morning. I'll tell you a little bit about it. And we will also be launching a Speak Up Caribbean campaign. And we have some colleagues here who would like to share a video with you. So let me begin by just introducing briefly the scope of our Memorandum of Understanding between the SALISES 50-50 Youth Cluster and the Caribbean Regional Youth Council. This MOU provides the basis for our partnership, which has the ultimate goal of advancing youth participatory research on Caribbean development issues. The specific objectives of this partnership are to advance an ongoing dialogue between 50-50 youth researchers and Caribbean youth representatives on youth development issues and priorities in the region. We will undertake, with youth participation, data collection on critical issues in youth development. We will build the capacity of the Caribbean Regional Youth Council, its constituent national youth councils, and other affiliate youth organizations to design, plan, and implement youth policy or development research projects. And we also hope to build the capacity of SALISES 50-50 youth to respond to the research needs of regional youth organizations. As a part of this MOU, the CRYC will become a formal member of the SALISES 50-50 youth cluster. We will work together to convene fora like these, like the Caribbean Youth Development Conference. And we will design and implement a long-term youth participatory research initiative, which will include research training of CRYC members and affiliates, including in youth social auditing, to build their capacity for evidence-based youth policy monitoring and evaluation. CRYC, its members and affiliates, will also participate in the data collection for the formulation of a youth participation index, the first in the region, in partnership with Olin Jovenes and Movimiento in Mexico, who has presented here at the conference on this initiative. We will also work together to jointly document the history and evolution of national youth councils. We had a little start of that yesterday with Justice Michelle's keynote address, and later this afternoon, Timothy Ferdinand will also offer a paper on the national youth councils in the region. And so those are some of the elements of this new partnership which we are launching this morning. And just as a symbolic act, I'm going to ask our acting director, Dr. Aldrin Henry Lee, and Timothy Ferdinand, the current chairman of the CRYC, to sign our MOU.
Now I'd like to invite Adrian Watson to introduce the Speak Up Caribbean campaign.
Good morning, everyone. Now, I have been asked to introduce the Speak Up Caribbean, and my presentation reads as follows. Youth delegates, youth workers, youth advocates of the Caribbean, are you craving for a youth movement in the region? Are you ready for a kind of movement that will allow marginalized youth to challenge the current political framework and status quo and to contribute positively to an environmental impact? Are you ready for the kind of movement which will allow you to allow unrepresented youths to lead the efforts of socioeconomic development in your community, national, and at regional levels? Well, this is why we are launching the Speak Up campaign. The Speak Up Caribbean campaign will develop as an initiative of the Jamaica School of Social Entrepreneurship in partnership with UNFPA Caribbean and SALISES 50/50 Youth to encourage youth to speak constructively on issues which impact their development that are directly linked to post-2015 agenda. The campaign will utilize the platforms to engage and inform youth after. It will utilize campaign to engage and inform SALISES Caribbean youths to develop their surroundings through conferences like the Caribbean Youth Development Conference that we are now attending, especially for underrepresented youths like myself. This will give opportunities for unappreciated and unrepresented youths to come and give their voice and lend their abilities to a particular initiative to make sure that youths are represented effectively. We hope that this particular campaign will give the voice of youths in both policy and project implementation. For the next 4 months, we will be flooding social media and traditional media entities throughout the region with youth's call for action, youth surveys, and monthly letters and articles to print media. The aim is to challenge our leaders to provide capacity and resources to implement sustainable development goals at all levels within the region with youth issues at its center. It is time for young people to change our mindset and realities and allow for youth to contribute and implement sustainable development goals both within a policy framework and within our communities at a local grassroots level. We talk amongst ourselves, and frankly, that talk is cheap, right? I know all too well of that. It is time for us to speak up, participate. It's time for us to take action, to challenge our leaders, and I'm glad to see leaders in the room. It is time for us to lead by doing. It is time for us to represent at the local grassroots level, at the national level, at the regional level, and I dare say at the international level. It is time for us to challenge the enablers of ministerial and political dysfunctions. Not trying to twist a knife there. It's time for us to practice the art of doing, and I do mean doing, tasks on the ground. This campaign is not about rocking the boat or turning out just a few heads for only a couple of days or for a couple of weeks. We want to turn full circle. It is time for us to create a kind of movement that creates everlasting change in light of real impact, using quality and not just quantity. Within the next 15 years and beyond, we want to put youth issues at the center of our focus. Therefore, we ask you to join us in making the first move to watching this, the video that will be shown next, for engaging your support for activities going forward to make sure that youth voice is a part of sustainable development going forward. I bid you to enjoy the videos that you will be seeing as a part of our presentation this morning. Thank you.
I don't feel our leaders listen when we speak.
I don't feel my voice really counts.
If I speak up, what happens next?
You can help to shape your future. Regional and global leaders, they want to hear from you. What would you like to say?
We need to take better care of the environment. Climate change real.
I need peace and security. I need to feel safe.
We need decent jobs. We need to be certain about our future.
What if you were given the resources to shape your future? What would you do?
I would promote equality at all levels. I would make justice the end of everything.
You know, I would provide better access to health and education services. That's what I would do.
I would make education more affordable and invest in research.
I would provide realistic opportunities for youth employment and entrepreneurship.
Caribbean youth, speak up!
I am Lenice Roden, and I speak up for the empowerment of girls and women. What do you speak up for?
Caribbean youth, participate!
I'm Nakadian Jones, and I've been an active participant in local, regional, and global youth initiatives. I'm an advocate for good governance and youth participation. Share with us, how are you participating?
Caribbean youth, take action.
I am Javin Williams and I create jobs to promote economic growth and development. How are you taking action?
Tell our leaders how you would like to be included in the implementation process of the post-2015 development agenda. Tell them what actions you would like to take to ensure sustainable development in our region. Give solutions and make recommendations.
Silence means everything is okay. So speak up.
Speak up.
Speak up.
Speak up.
Share your views and your ideas. Make recommendations as well on our Facebook page and on Twitter using hashtag SpeakUpCaribbean.
Together, we can ensure that the post-2015 development agenda promotes human rights, health and well-being of the largest generation of young people in history.
To sky, to sky.
That was very inspiring, and if I was not interested or very timid, I'll be encouraged to speak out. And that video asks the right questions, it makes the right assumptions. So thank you very much for the initiative, and we look forward to actually participating. And using the hashtag. Last night we spoke about the issue of social media and whether it's relevant. And I think it has great relevance when it comes to trying to bring people together across waters. So it has a role to play in development. This morning, the third thing we're going to do is hear from Miss Tahere Siisiialafia from Samoa. She is the deputy global focal point for the UN Major Group for Children and Youth and the executive board member of the Pacific Youth Council. And today she will be speaking to us on the topic Small Island Developing States, insights from the Talavou Youth Outcomes document. I will just read a short bio on her for you to know exactly what background she is coming from. Tahere has been involved in community development, especially with children and youth, all her life through faith-based activities and as part of youth-led non-governmental organizations, including the social work NGO called Really Make a Difference. It served socially deprived young persons in squatter settlements in Fiji. In 2013, Tahere was elected as an executive board member of the Pacific Youth Council, which is a regional youth-led NGO platform to advocate the interests, needs, and development of young people in the Pacific region. In that role, she has been representing Pacific young people at national, regional, and international events, and especially in the various post-2015 agenda processes, with the key regional and international events, and especially in the various post-2015 agenda processes, with the key aim of promoting global understanding of issues affecting young people in small island developing states, while also fostering cooperation and collaboration amongst youth development partners towards promoting greater engagement and participation of young people. Most recently, she has served as the PYC representative to the UN Women's Major Group and was appointed as deputy global focal point for the UN Major Group for Children and Youth, in which she coordinates training activities in various UN processes. Additionally, she is a member of the advisory board for the International Young Feminists Fund. Tahere is from Samoa. She has completed her bachelor's degree in sociology and psychology at the University of the South Pacific in Fiji, and is now completing her master's in social work at the University of the West Indies in Jamaica. In her own words, Tahere has indicated that advancing youth development is at the heart of my interests, and my ambition is to ensure that the voices and concerns of young people from the small island developing states are not only heard, but are also reflected in the various UN global processes. With that, I would like you to put your hands together for Tahere.
Honorable ministers, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, blessed good morning to you all. And as we greet in my mother tongue, Talofalava, I am very, very humbled and very grateful to have been given this opportunity to participate in this conference, nonetheless delivering the closing address. I owe all gratitude to SALISES for all the support, and more importantly, Dr. Terri-Ann Gilbert Roberts, who has really been the one who has engaged me from the beginning up till now. Thank you very much. So please join me in giving a round of applause for Dr. Gilbert Roberts and her amazing team for this wonderful conference. Usually when I hear the terms closing address or opening address and so forth, I tend to automatically think giving a speech. So I've put a little twist to it, hoping that I won't bore you out of your chairs this morning. Before I go into the main purpose of my presentation this morning, I wanted to quickly just share with you very briefly on my Pacific Youth Council. So the Pacific Youth Council is about 3 years old now, and we've progressed so much within such a short time since we've revived the Pacific Youth Council in 2009. We are a regional NGO serving as a platform to promote the interests and needs of young people in the Pacific. At the moment, we currently have 10 national youth councils that have been fully revived and are on their feet at the moment, but we're trying to establish or revive national youth councils across all the 22 Pacific Island countries. We have, we have 8 board members, and it's a regional organization, but we have only one full-time staff, and that's our secretariat. Our main focused areas are mainly capacity building, networking, and advocacy, both on a regional level and at the same time, building the capacity of our national youth councils or our 10 members in terms of networking with the regional and international constituencies, such as at the moment it's the UN Major Group for Children and Youth. And for advocacy, we don't have a specific thematic area for advocacy. We participate in advocacy across a wide range of thematic areas for youth issues. And our key partners are basically the AusAid and the Secretariat of the Pacific Community, which is housing the Pacific Youth Council at the moment. Now to the main purpose of my presentation. To the young people who are in the room, how many of you are aware of SIDS? Okay, and how many of you feel that there is very low awareness on SIDS in the Caribbean, especially in regards to young people? Okay, thanks. Okay, great. So this morning I will be sharing on the SIDS Talavou outcome statement from the 3rd International SIDS Conference that happened in Samoa last year. And the main document, or the Samoa pathway, is available online for your convenience, but I will just be focusing mainly on the youth outcomes statement. So this document, the Talavou SIDS outcomes document, basically recalls on the priorities and the call for action to the Barbados Program of Action and the Mauritius strategy for implementation and other documentations throughout the preparatory meetings that were leading up to the main conference in Samoa. And over there, that's like the main mission or the main slogan that we want to put out there in terms of youth in SIDS youth, sorry. So therefore, young people of SIDS have laid out a vision of the future that they want, and that is having a self-sustaining, climate resilient, peaceful, healthy, inclusive, responsive, democratic, and transparent society where all young people are empowered as equal partners in global efforts for sustainable development. So in Samoa, the young people from across the 3 SIDS regions who came together reviewed and reshaped the SIDS youth priorities. So while recognizing the differences which exist between our regions, 6 thematic areas were highlighted by those who attended as critical to the livelihoods of young people in SIDS. So as you could see up there, the first one is good governance and youth participation. Sustainable development cannot be achieved in SIDS without a common vision, intergenerational and inclusive dialogue, and solidarity among young people. Thus, young people acknowledge their role as partners in effective youth participation in decision and policy-making processes. Health. Services and support for mental health, NCDs and STIs among young people within all SIDS have been generally neglected or underfunded, which has resulted in the prevalence of mental illnesses, substance abuse and suicide, STIs and child obesity. So young people from the SIDS call for the need for a stable, hygienic, and healthy life, for prosperous living, and in order to contribute towards sustainable island development. The third is climate change and biodiversity. It is strongly linked to the development in SIDS, and it is a matter of survival and resilience of our islands. And this is what sets us all different from all other regions or continents around the globe. So intergenerational equity is crucial. Given the importance of engaging all generations in climate change and biodiversity discussions, planning, and decision making, inclusive of all young people across the SIDS regions. In the Pacific, we have been hit by a few very strong cyclones in just the past 2 years, and some of our islands are already threatened to be relocated from their home islands. Water, oceans, and sustainable energy. As we all know, water is essential for all aspects of life, and there is a direct link between water, ocean, and energy. Saving of energy is the saving of water, and there is a strong need for more focus on local ways to implement energy and water security solutions. The young people of SIDS also take into account that most member states have articulated their concerns with regard to the degradation of marine ecosystems and the importance of the blue economy, underscoring that oceans are indeed the future of SIDS. Education, entrepreneurship, and employment. According to the findings published by ILO in 2013, young people are 3 times more likely to be unemployed than adults, and almost 73 million youth worldwide are looking for work. So that pretty much says a lot about the challenge for young people in terms of education and employment. Science and technology. Science and technology is the engine of industry and can provide solutions to many of the issues facing our SIDS countries. The minds of youth are the pistons that keep this engine moving forward. We need partnerships with the government and private sector in research and development capacities, opportunities, and avenues in the science and technology field. For this, the young people really encourage other young people to adopt a research-focused perspective. What we also did after identifying and defining these 6 thematic areas, we broke into our regional groups and pinpointed regional focus areas. So the aims highlighted connectivity, while the Pacific emphasized on spiritual approaches and sports. And here in the Caribbean, they had those who attended highlighted 2 main areas, and that is in relations to reducing gender-based violence, and also in terms of creating research and creating database for young people. Nonetheless, we came to the conclusion that in order for us to fully accomplish all our goals and implement these call for actions by young people in this document, we call for governments, private sectors, and all stakeholders, and we strongly urge you to put in place an overarching monitoring mechanism for youth through a formal structure. And we put the example there, like the UN Major Group of Children and Youth. Also, young people ourselves need to take charge and be committed ourselves. We can have all the passion in the world, but without direction and without commitment, we're not going nowhere, right? So, why is SIDS important? And why is it important for young people to be aware of SIDS? On a global scale, it has been recognized that although we are afflicted by economic difficulties and confronted by development imperatives similar to those of developing countries around the globe generally, SIDS have their own peculiar, unique, and particular vulnerabilities and characteristics. So we are known for being small in size, remoteness, narrow resource and export base, and exposure to global environment challenges and external economic shocks, including to a large range of impacts from climate change and potentially more frequent and intense natural disasters. So how do we apply the SAMO pathway modalities to regional and to national levels, and also the Talavou Youth Outcomes document? On the first day of the conference, we looked at some of the international and regional youth frameworks in place. And then just recently, our leaders have just endorsed the 17 global goals for sustainable development. And then we have our own national youth policies and our own national youth frameworks on the national level. I don't know if you agree, but I think it's very overwhelming. So I feel that most often we look at these regional and especially the international frameworks and modalities and say, for example, how will Samoa's national youth development framework fit into, say, the Commonwealth's or the UN's youth frameworks? I think it should be the other way around. How can or how does, you know, the new SDGs or the World Program of Action for Youth, the Commonwealth Plan of Action, the CARICOM Youth Development Action Plan, how do all of these fit into our own national youth development frameworks? And same goes for the Samoa Pathway and the SIDS Youth Outcomes document. How do these six priorities fit into our national youth policy or action plans? On that note, I think it's important that we as young people think of what role we play for SIDS. I'm from the Pacific, and we are different from the Caribbean, but what sets you and I on the same platform is that we are SIDS. And there's only three SIDS regions fighting against a lot of global threats, so only together we can put up a strong fight, especially against climate change. And COP21 is soon to happen, and the Pacific Climate Change Warriors, which is the majority, are young people, are well underway in preparing for the COP21, but we need the Caribbean on board, and we need the AIMS on board. So, the theme for this conference is Directions for Sustainable Development in the Caribbean. In the past 2 days, we consulted on and we mapped out challenges and opportunities in relations to policy, research, programs, and various youth development frameworks, and also looked at some of the best practices from the various stakeholders participating in this conference. So I know it's been very intense, but now what? Right? Where do we go from here? In one of the presentations yesterday, youth conferencing was discussed, and the presenter posed the question of whether or not these conferences are transformative or are they just mere tyranny. I guess that will just depend on us who are here and what we will do when we go back, right, to our countries, back to our desks. So I'll just share a few thoughts in terms of a way forward. I think they're a call to rethink. We have all these various youth frameworks, and on top of that, the SDGs. And it was mentioned on the first day that a major challenge is integrating these frameworks together. So we need to really rethink our directions. Do they uphold Caribbean identity, unity, and solidarity? Do they promote prosperous, compassionate, and a just Caribbean? Are they visionary, transformative, and constructive? From our perspective, we need to rethink our pool of resource personnel in terms of the Caribbean expertise, thinkers, and reflective practitioners. In addition to that, as we rethink, we need to redefine some of these international frameworks to fit our regional frameworks and regional to fit our national frameworks, thus hold meaningful reviews and consultations with young people. Reshaping the Caribbean we want. We need to shape what we want through articulation and assertion of Caribbean civil society perspectives. We need to have models. We need to have shadow reviews of regional and national plans for youth. We need to reflect on development models that are in place and reevaluate their effectiveness. We need to learn from the best practices, and here including informal youth work, to inform and influence national, regional, and global agendas. Last but not least, we need to look at the processes, the space, and actors across all the disciplines of youth development. What would be a structured process for effective and meaningful dialogues with young people? Is it just a matter of just bringing them into the room, talk to them, send them back, or what? We need to reclaim spaces. We young people need to reclaim spaces that are meant to be ours and be at the center of development. For instance, the developing of youth policies is rightfully a space for young people, so claim it. Who are the key actors and who are the genuine actors? Because we can have key actors, but are they really establishing a genuine relationship with us young people? What are the linkages for local, national, regional, and international that we need to tap into? SIDS, I think, is one of the links that the Pacific, the Caribbean, and AIMS region can come very closely on a global level. It is also important that we bridge the gaps between the grassroots and national level, and also the gap between academia and activism. Nonetheless, in the first day, we raised the issues concerning deadlines. So how much time do we give ourselves, and how do we hold others accountable without creating trouble or causing trouble? So ladies and gentlemen, how long have we been in the same place, discussing the same issues and promising the same solutions and making the same pledges over and over and over? What will it take for us to make a major leap ahead? I want to show, I came across this video and it was quite amusing, but I actually kind of got a little message from it, so. How you see it, but for me, that's what good and genuine partnerships should look like. If our governments flip over, or if our government leaders flip over, let's flip them back on their feet. If young people flip over, flip us back, as stated in our SIDS youth vision, treat us as your partners in sustainable development. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'll just leave you with this. That young people are significant partners and actors of in sustainable development. So make us count. It's been a very intensive 3 days, and I hope you all have had and enjoyed learning and sharing with each other. And I do hope that we make most of today, the last few sessions of today. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tahere, for sharing your experience in representing young people of the Pacific. Up to last night, I was going over the Pacific Youth Council and checking for similarities with the Caribbean Regional Youth Council and different entities in the region that's advocating for young persons. We must admit that we need each other, and national youth councils need to be able to embrace other actors within the arena of youth development and advocacy. With that, I would like to thank you for your closing address. And I know we are tight on time, so we'll take a few questions. Any question that you may have or any comments you want to make on her presentation?
Comments would be great.
Comments and questions. So we have two.
Hi, my name is Nefali Gali. I'm from Haiti. Okay, we all know that the seeds are facing, like what we can say, natural challenges, like small size, that means small market, that means small economy, so limited voice at the international level. So what we need is we need to be together in order to have our voice considered at the international level. Unfortunately, this is not what happened in the innovation, right? And we are facing like the curriculum is failing, or regional integration is failing because of political selfishness. So let me give you a good example of that is happening right here in this conference. You just signed a partnership with SALISES, CRYC and SALISES, to reinforce national responses in order to help them to empower young people. But what about Haiti? Haiti doesn't have a national response. So you want to move forward, lagging behind Haiti? Let me tell you that. The curriculum will be developed when Haiti will be developed. And Haiti will be developing when its young people will be developing. So if we can't stop our selfishness and to help, like we say with this video, help each other, nothing can. We will not have our voices heard, and the curriculum will be like on the same level for all the time.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Nadia Saa, and I'm representing a youth organization from Guadeloupe called the Collective Jeunesse Guadeloupe. And as you can hear, I'm from Guadeloupe, I'm French people. During this conference, I was afraid to speak, not because of my French accent, but because of the high quality of the comments made during this conference, and I must confess that I am really impressed. So first of all, I would like to thank you, Timothy, because our presence as French Caribbean, they were two colleagues of mine, but they had to leave, so they are not here right now. So I would like to thank you, Timothy, once again, because our presence today as French Caribbean island is the result of the first step of a cooperation built together between our islands and that organization. And I hope for the future, we as French West Indies will be more involved in what youth organizations are doing, because unfortunately, as French citizens in the Caribbean, I must confess that even if we are in the Caribbean, we are sidelined of what Caribbean are doing. And I truly think we can build a strong cooperation together between youth organizations such as CRYC, such as Collective Jeunesse Guadeloupe and Martinique Anti-Development, and others like SALISES, NYCs, and CRYC. And I'm looking forward to continuing our cooperation. The Honorable Maria Michelle made yesterday a wonderful and inspiring presentation. When I will return to Guadeloupe, I will report and share what I've seen and heard so far. By saying that, I'm thinking about, for example, the implementation of National Youth Council in our French countries, in our French Caribbean islands, in order to work together, because we share the same point of view, the same issues as young people in the Caribbean. And I will conclude by quoting the Trinidadian national motto by saying, together we aspire, together we achieve. Thank you very much.
I just wanted to commend Tahere on a wonderful presentation, paying very close attention to youth and environmental issues when she mentioned something about the green and the blue economy. even at this particular conference, save and except for the session that I participated in with my presentation, there was nothing really including environment and youth issues on that, right? And especially for example, I'm Jamaican, so I can only speak to my Jamaican experience, where our forests are being cut down. We only have 30% of our forest, natural forest left. And even that is being invaded by invasive species. Even though, despite the fact that we have a forestry department, we also have a marine ecosystem that is being polluted. And if you had paid attention to my reports, my presentation yesterday, you'd have heard me speak about the influx of soil waste in mangrove ecosystem. And as Caribbean islands, we don't pay much attention to it unless sargassum, as in the case of Barbados and Trinidad and now Jamaica, the coast is now being eroded and it's now threatening things like tourism, which we are paying a lot of attention to. So not unless it's starting to impact our livelihood, then it becomes important. But then we only solve the symptoms, we only treat the symptoms by doing beach cleanup days every year, but we don't seek to change the culture of how we treat with our waste. So we only look at the social side of it, but we don't look at the environmental impacts of the generation that will be left behind. And I'm hearing our elders being very happy to die and leave us behind. Really? So, in your haste to die and leave us behind, I think you should be looking at how you can help us solve the environmental impact that you have caused from your generation 50 years ago, 20 years ago, and I dare say 10 years ago, and 150 years ago. Because guess what? The very children that you leave behind will have to clean up your mess. Start by helping us to clean up your mess. You owe us that much.
All right, with that said, do you have any comments on what was said? Okay, one more comment and we will close up. Yes.
Can I just object to what you just said as an elder? Because older people, and maybe not my generation, but certainly people older than we never had as many environmental issues. We never used things like plastics and et cetera, et cetera. So I think we were more environmentally conscious. Well, I don't know if people in this part of the region invented. But I just wanted to, since you said that and I was moved to comment, can I just say two quick things? One, I think missing from the thematic areas is the issue of strong and responsible parenting. I think youth should demand that.
Yes.
I hear us attacking the leaders, and sometimes we are all. I was once a young person, and I too struggled with all of the issues, and I believe everybody inside here struggled with the issues that young people are currently facing. So let's recognize that, one, a lot of the leaders are on a learning curve as well. We were of a generation where you had to be seen and not heard. And we are having to accept a generation and to deal with a generation who has to be seen and heard. So we are all on a learning curve, and I think we need to recognize this. And I just want to stress, as a sociologist, that the issue of strong and responsible parenting should also be a concern of young people. You should demand that your parents act with some amount of responsibility in how we parent and how we make families, etc. Because let's face it, some of these leaders are having to deal with irresponsible parenting, irresponsible family making, etc. So I think those are things which I would wanted to bring to the fore. And last thing, that youth are heterogeneous. So where are poor youth's voices, very poor, who you don't see at all? Where are those who are gifted on the other end of the spectrum? Their voices too are to be heard. I am very concerned about what is happening to this region that we call the Caribbean, because I think it is losing the hope of a lot of young people, and young people's parents too, some of us who are in our 40s and early 50s, who feel a certain sense of hopelessness. And I don't know that the region, and given globalization and all the networks that the world has shrunken, so people are discovering their talents in ways that this Caribbean will never be able to absorb. Its economies, etc., just will not be able to. And the mass migration, therefore, of highly trained young people from this region, the hemorrhage, is a great concern to me. So this is something that our leaders have to be concerned with. I am, you know.
Pay them well.
Well, how are you going to pay them well? Because that's an economic argument, it's a development argument. I mean, it's a big complex, it's a very complex issue. And I am agreeing that young people have to sit with older people to speak. I mean, the way forward, I think, has to be an inclusive, participatory way forward. And I mean, I'm very happy that this conference is taking place. It's perhaps the first of its kind. But let's just recognize, with due respect to the leaders and older people, that they too are on a learning curve. And we do have to meet each other halfway. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very, very much. We'll have to wrap up here. But I just want to make sure we have taken note of our brother from Haiti. He has been making a call the entire week. They feel excluded. And I think even from the French West Indies as well, there's that feeling of exclusion. So we should pay attention to that for this afternoon. I'd like to call on Tijani Christian. Are you here? Yes. To give thanks to our closing speaker.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Wonderful. I'm going to reverse it to Dr. Ricketts' vibrant community. On behalf of the Rowan here, the Caribbean Development Conference, I just want to thank you, Tahere. You're really admirable, a young person. Having met you just 2 months. Come on. All right, I won't touch your hand. I've just met you 2 months ago and seen your development and what you've done. And to make your presentation here today, I know truly that it takes bravery, and we applaud your effort and continue to do the work you're doing. God bless.
Thank you very much, Tijani. We now break out into the conference sessions.